run a motorcycle shop here in Calgary called T.J. CYCLE. When I was a child, my mother would wag her finger at me and she'd say, "Mark!" She always sounded like a crow when she called my name. "Mark, don't you ever ride motorcycles, don't you ever take drugs, and don't you ever get tattooed." I guess I never got tattooed. I'm a machinist by trade. So when God in his infinite wisdom flicked the customized motorcycle switch in the back of my head, I found I was in the perfect position to apply my skills to a mobile art form. And before you could say, "Plan via plus wingeth, windre goth, tranquisilian, go, go, go," I had joined the National Chopper Club of Great Britain. My very first build was not a custom, but in fact was a recreation of a small BSA Bantam I had bought in order to save me catching the bus. I somehow tried to convince my mum that it was not for riding, but I just bought it to work on. Having my mate Nigel crash it into the old man's car didn't exactly convince her either. But the act itself forced my hand and I found myself rebuilding a pile of rubbish. After that, I felt more inclined to tackle more involved projects. And my first real chopper creation was thrown together from a small BSA basket case. Now I look back, it made Quasimodo look like the male model for a Sears catalogue. But I have to say, the building of that bike lit a fire inside me. I was hooked. I was an addict. And there was not going to be any motorcycle that I didn't want to customise from here on in. My peers and I consider this affliction a disease, and it is incurable. Anyway, I made the first step in customising motorcycles. It performed, it had mild appeal, and some fool liked it enough to trade me for a bigger machine. My family had also come to realise that if I was working on bikes, I wasn't out and about getting into trouble. Well, that's what they thought, anyway. But I still had a lot to learn. And during my apprenticeship, I learned to enjoy being given mundane jobs. They would allow me time to think about the bikes I was building and how I was going to approach a particular problem in the build. I would get home at the end of the day and immediately apply solutions I'd been thinking about to the bike. I would do as much as possible to the machine in the evening and make drawings of parts I needed to create at work the next day. I would then get busy making said parts during my lunch hour so I could continue to work on the project when I got home. Now, wouldn't it be nice if everything we designed and built worked first time? I'm afraid life isn't like that. If you don't look ahead to the positioning of all the components, especially at the chain and how it reacts under load and deceleration, you can get into a lot of trouble. I ended up having to reduce the size of an electrical box because I positioned it right where the chain wanted to run. And boy, did I feel stupid. I'd also positioned my oil tank in a location above the chain, but not far enough away to avoid it being beaten to death like the Exxon Valdez was on the rocks. These problems were overcome with some creative thinking, a bandsaw and an oxyacetylene welder. But it was the knowledge gained from these experiences that earned me huge credibility with the president of a certain outlaw club, because I pointed out the problem while he was in the process of doing the same thing to his girlfriend's bike. And he certainly appreciated the fact that I didn't let him fall into the looking stupid trap. When talking about custom bikes, there are many different styles. You may hear the words like chop, bobber, cafe racer, or street fighter bandied about. But the ultimate object of the exercise is to make a motorcycle look good. Flow is an important aspect of the build. Your eye should fall onto the machine and take it all in from the front to the rear wheel without any visual interruptions. And when building a custom motorcycle, with the exception of my aforementioned Quasimodo, I try to create form with function. I once had a thing for the lowrider style of build. That was a machine with a very, very low center, seat height and therefore a low center of gravity. And not only was it handy for cornering, but it was also damn useful for getting under a big rig's trailer in a tight spot. this was a very dangerous activity and not recommended for the clinically sane. When the bike is finished, it should not just look good, but be easy to ride. They made the film called Easy Riders, but Peter Fonda and Dennis Hopper never had to suffer Calgary's roads with no suspension. Riding a bike with no suspension might be fun and look good, but it's damn hard on the back. The joke is, a lot of these machines can be totally impractical to ride. Here I come back to form with function. And the style of build that became the ultimate functioning custom motorcycle was the Street Fighter. I'm sorry, I haven't got any pictures of it here. This is not one. Right? Yeah, it's not one of those. In the motorcycle world, the Street Fighter is not someone who walks down Stevens Avenue Mall looking like Mike Tyson. It is a style of motorcycle that retained its original suspension and therefore its original handling, and was developed from some of the early Japanese, and in my case, Italian motorcycles that we had to hand. These were quick and easy builds. We'd cut the seat height down, throw in a different gas tank, handlebars, fender, call it done. They obtained the name Street Fighter because bikes became ideal platforms for racing from traffic light to traffic light. Today, the Street Fighter is based on a large capacity sport bike with the plastics removed and the motors producing large horsepower. I was obsessed by these machines, and I used to dream about them. I would visualize each one finished and on the road. I also dreamt of what I thought would be paradise. It was a vision of endless motorcycles to play with and to mold into my own styles. It was this dream that led me to T.J S CYCLE, where the potential projects are endless. I purchased the business and selfishly started building my own toys. Here I discovered a problem. Other people wanted me to do things for them. Who knew? I put down my own desires and focused on the business. It is primarily a wrecking yard where we sell used parts. The T.J S CYCLE crest was given to me with a knighthood from the Queen. That's a lie. She didn't invite me to the wedding. I made up the crest to represent what we do at the shop. We take the unfortunate customers' crash machines and then part them out for profit. The ribbon shape at the top of the shield represents the motorcycle. The axe represents the cutting up or the chopping of the machines, and the broken piston represents misfortune. The laughing skull is just a laughing skull, but my friends say it's me after making a deal on a bike. So the translation of the Latin, lucro conficio infelicitas, means profit from misfortune, which is what we do. It also has a more profound meaning, believe me. It also means that we learn from our mistakes. And in so doing, we can pass on those experiences onto helping others. The fact is, the true route to finding joy is in helping others to create their own forms of two-wheel joy. Not only does this earn me loyal customers, but it also earns me the occasional bottle of single malt scotch. Not many of you drinkers? I have 35 years of building experience to fall back on and when helping a customer with their ideas and designs. And in some cases, I've had to burst bubbles of creative thought because of the total impracticality of their engineering designs. Also, this experience gives us an advantage in fixing customers' bikes that are in for regular service. We often find older bikes with seized or broken bolts and damaged bearings, cracked mufflers, that sort of thing. And it is our experience, along with the equipment that we use to build with, that allows us to repair their machines with comparative ease, thus saving them a lot of money. And being as most of our customers are cheap bastards, and not afraid to admit it, this keeps them happy. In conclusion, having built a wide variety of machines, I have found and overcome many flaws in different builds, but I find it is the challenge in overcoming the problems and helping the customer, that makes a build more satisfying. Thank you.